Good afternoon, we are at the Gator Blockchain Conference at the University of Florida, and with me I have Alex from Tetris Capital. He is a former UF alumni that studied finance while at the University of Florida, and he was originally the creator of a startup called Landmower that is going to explain us more, and is currently he quit his job in the traditional finance world to work in a hedge fund management firm in New York called Tetris, and is going to talk a bit more about his career and what he did with his startup in crypto.
Yep. So I guess my first jump into crypto was when I started a company called Landmower in late 2014 with two of my friends also from University of Florida, both software engineers. It was called Landmower. The original iteration was essentially convert your spare change into Bitcoin. There's actually an app called Acorns, more in the equities world, where you do this. It's a real passive investment strategy to kind of dollar cost average over time into a given asset. So the idea was you essentially link a credit or debit card up to this app as you go around and make purchases, like buy a coffee at Starbucks for $3.75. The app would track that, automatically round it up to the next dollar, so $4 in this case, and automatically buy Bitcoin with that 25 cents. So over time, as you're spending on various things, you're also buying Bitcoin. So we launched this in 2014 after Bitcoin had been going down for 18 months and people were generally scared. What price do I buy at? How much money do I put in, etc.? And our sort of solution was this easy dollar cost average passive way to get in. And over time, we added support for new assets like Ether. We also added research, and we're trying to be this sort of full comprehensive investment platform for news, trading, research, etc.
Yeah, that's something we advise our subscribers is to dollar cost average. Never jump to the market at the same time and just like cliff jump, because you're gonna get hurt.
Yeah, and one of the easy nice things about Bitcoin is you can just buy a fraction, so you don't need to buy a full Bitcoin. Yeah. You know, a lot of people are kind of freaked out, so hey, just buy $5, buy $10 next week, just slowly get in. Don't try and time the market, don't jump in too aggressively.
Yeah, and it's interesting that you mentioned the bear market of 2013 and 14, because that was a crazy what happened back then, which is very similar to 2017. And for those of you who don't know, what happened was Bitcoin was about $100 or $90, and you went up to $1,000.
Yep.
So fortunes were made in that bull market run.
And then over the next 18 months, it came down like 80%, which is very analogous to right now.
It's so similar. So this seems a trend that's repeating and repeating. Do you think this trend will repeat maybe in the next 4 years or 5 years?
Well, the interesting part about 2015 is, like you said, we came down like 80%. And that period, looking back now, is what a lot of people describe as like the development or the building period. So much like today, you see at DEF CON, the Ethereum community is pretty down about the price, but you know, one thing is good about price, people are not talking and focusing about it. So right now is when hopefully these developers are hunkering down, actually building out the tech to actually make reality catch up a little bit with expectations. And that's really what happened. I think the market just got ahead of itself with ICO mania and the thought of just decentralizing everything, and now kind of rationality just came back into place. But and like you said though, hopefully the next year or hopefully the last 6 months too have been characterized with a lot of development, and then we'll actually, you know, get the returns from that in the coming years, which I'm very bullish on.
You're very bullish on the whole industry and the crypto market.
I would say I'm very bullish about certain assets over others, of course, but generally I think a lot of work has been done. The talent and the capital that's been put into crypto at this point is just not going to go away. So the whole crypto asset class, blockchain as a whole, DLT, whatever flavors we're going to see, I mean, it's just at a minimum, some flavor of that is not going to go away anytime soon.
Yeah, and it's definitely a technology that's here to stay.
Absolutely.
And this morning you just wrote an article that I was reading on CoinDesk.
Yep.
About the incoming wave of regulations to ICOs. And obviously the market got really ahead of itself. And there is this crypto anarchy manifest where it is decentralized, no government rules, and people just think we don't need the permission of the state. And now the regulators are catching up and regulation is coming. So what is your opinion about what is about to happen in the next few years?
So it's interesting because, like I said, I'm bullish on the overall asset class as a whole, but I definitely think some assets within the asset class are significantly overvalued, while some are undervalued. Undervalued, pretty bullish on Bitcoin. I think it's, you know, the clear leader right now for the store value market, which is massive. Some of these assets, though, have a lot of regulatory risk, both in the fact that they might currently be securities and the fact that they might have done an unregistered illegal securities offering, which at least from the perspective of the SEC and US issuances is not okay. And the thing is, you know, in 2014, 15, before regulators had really caught up, you know, there was this attitude of there hasn't been any action that has gone down. You know, I should grab this money as quick as I can, really while the market is hot, or else I'd kind of just passed up this capital and maybe a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Mm-hmm. But the hard thing now is as these tokens try and move, you know, away from securities jurisdiction, and maybe they can get decentralized enough to not be a security like Ether, but the problem is, you can't get away from how it started. So that's the problem with a lot of these assets. It's just the birth. Yeah, was it birthed with pure fair mining like Bitcoin, or was it birthed with this sort of coin offering? And then the ones with coin offering,
it's like an IPO
needs to be, you know, registered. So
by accredited investors, which U.S. citizens are not accredited investors.
All of them. Well, the big thing is just you need to basically tell U.S. regulators that you're about to do a sale of, you know, securities. And in this ICO, it's just kind of raise money as fast as possible, and then you didn't do the initial sort of requirements. So that's one of the big concerns.
Sorry to go ahead.
I was just going to say, and one of the problems too is a lot of these tokens that are already live and trading can be deemed securities sort of now. And the risk of that is also, as an exchange, you need specific licenses to trade securities. So if a given, let's say Ripple was deemed a security, any exchange trading Ripple that doesn't have securities licensings would have to immediately delist that asset, or else they would get in trouble too. So it's like, this can quickly sort of spiral down.
And it could cause another huge bear market possibly.
Yeah. But, you know, thankfully, like I said, I am bullish in the overall asset class. Not all of them were birthed this way. You know, the big difficulty of this whole space is just filtering out quality from risk.
I mean, we have about 2,200.
I'm sure there's probably 100 more in the last hour.
And Bitcoin, actually, as you showed in your presentation, has been very less volatile compared with other assets, even the S&P 500 and tech stocks, which is amazing.
Yeah, it really is. Yeah, the volatility is down to like a 1.5% average daily change over the last 30 days, which is absolutely tiny. The band it's gone into is quite tight, like you said.
Is it true holders at this phase?
It's just kind of like I said, I feel like at this point, if you were going to sell, you had so many chances throughout 2018, and everyone's kind of too scared to buy. It's like everyone right now is kind of just scared and holding what they have, and people are just kind of waiting. That seems like a lot of general market sentiment.
No, but that's definitely, you bring a great perspective, and probably, and one of our fears is that the US is becoming very anti-crypto in a sense, where people go jurisdiction shopping.
Yeah.
To jurisdictions like Switzerland, the city of Zug.
Yep.
Where it's being this new hub. And then we have Malta as another jurisdiction, and Singapore, Hong Kong.
Yep.
So do you think that with these regulations from the SEC and other agencies, do you think that they're taking innovation away from the US?
Yeah, so that's the huge thing is, a lot of people are saying the U.S. is going to stifle innovation, crypto is a huge market opportunity, and they're going to lose it to these other countries. And we like those examples you said. Another good one is also Binance. I mean, they will literally just change their headquarters if given jurisdiction doesn't like what they're trading. And like in today's world, that's just bound to happen. I think it's almost a good thing it's so global. But to your point, I think the U.S. will maybe lose some market share in the short to medium term by giving away some of these more kind of gray market issuances. I think the U.S. wants just the quality issuances and is almost fine losing the market share on those kind of subpar offers. So to your point, maybe yes, they would lose some market share, but I also can understand the rationale and not wanting to be associated with some of these more high-flying ICOs.
Do you think it's a disadvantage to the general public that they can't invest in great companies like Uber or Airbnb because they're not a qualified investor? And now with ICOs, they have the opportunity, but regulation is coming and that will be taken away. So what do you think? You think it should be like just open to everyone or?
Yeah, it's really interesting. I mean, it's funny. It's like investor protection acts were created for a reason, to protect investors, because a lot of these unsophisticated investors, which I think money is a terrible representation for how accredited or knowledgeable you are. I mean, I do think they were created to protect people. I don't think that money has anything to do with how intelligent you are, so I feel like that bar is weird. I feel like the Jobs Act and normal regulation is trying to move towards getting, you know, less wealthy people a little more opportunity to invest in startups. But a lot of what drew me into crypto in the first place was generally how open it is to anyone in the world being able to trade or invest in anything. And I do think being shut out of deals like doesn't feel good. It's totally against the crypto ethos. And I do think, I mean, part of the reason I like crypto is definitely to open opportunities for everyone. So it's I'm like conflicted on how exactly that should go down. I don't think it should be full anarchy. I understand why some of these protections are there, but I also like crypto because, you know, it gives us opportunities.
And we also have a good example of something that happened recently was BitConnect, where so many people, because they didn't do properly their homework or they just got caught in the hype, they invested in an asset that they completely lost. And then if the company is not based in the US, the US government cannot go after them and pursue these individuals. So it's really trying to balance.
Well, it's kind of like the core ethos of Bitcoin is like, don't trust, verify, right? So a lot of even the investment at the end of the day, it is making just people more like personally responsible. Like, okay, you need to do your own diligence on these assets. There's not investor protection. You're not like relying on a broker or something. I think in general, crypto's probably made people more skeptical and more analytical themselves, which I'd at least like to hope. But yeah, if anything, hopefully just this whole movement of be your own bank, don't trust anyone, verify everything, hopefully trickles down into people sort of doing more diligence on their investments as well. But
yeah, and I was going to ask you, as working in the hedge fund world, do you think right now at this moment we have the solutions in terms of storage and security to hold trillions of dollars in crypto assets, or are we still in progress?
Yeah, right now, I mean, especially in the last few years, I mean, the managers were mostly people that had been in the crypto industry for a while with really niche experience. These third-party qualified custodians like almost didn't exist. Like there were ways to custody assets, and we saw, you know, the first movers were individuals and some family offices that just have less strict mandates and are almost just investing their own wealth from a you know, more flexible mandate. So those people were okay taking a risk of kind of less secure and understood custody solutions. Right now, I think, you know, custody's really getting going with stuff like Fidelity and BitGo and et cetera. And I think this is helping new institutions come in. So essentially, I guess what I'm saying is, you had to be like very niche and almost crypto native to be managing money in the past and very comfortable with the risks of that, not holding it with qualified custodians. So it kept some more traditional conservative institutions out just because they weren't willing to take that risk, which also kind of created a small market opportunity for those that were and people that, you know, trusted the process and people managing funds. So, I mean, it's only getting better for more institutional capital to come in, but then again, you know, we'll have to deal with the potential downfalls of whatever institutionalization means that we've been talking about for like 5-10 years at this point.
Yeah, definitely. New institutions coming and all that capital flowing also means the regulation. They want to certain the regulatory field, they don't want to be doing something wrong.
Yeah, and it's almost like, you know, as you're talking about, like, what about these good custody solutions? And I'm like, a third-party qualified custodian. It's like, well, isn't the entire point of crypto to get away from that? It's almost like we're kind of like rewinding.
Holding your private key.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, so these new institutions that are getting into Bitcoin are, they want crypto exposure, but they're not even getting Bitcoin. So it's like kind of this weird thing at the end of the day.
And
like
Bitcoin is the port of entry.
Yes, exactly. Bitcoin is the on-ramp for the whole industry, absolutely.
Yes. And so, I was going to ask, where do you see all this industry in the next 20 or 30 years?
Yeah, kind of like I said, I mean, I'm pretty bullish, obviously, on these public permissionless assets like Bitcoin. I think that'll be sort of the core infrastructure layer for everything in the future. And I hope I'm at least kind of bullish that right now. I think Bitcoin's at least sort of leading the race. I think it's going to be the most secure asset. And if sort of the vision of sidechains are implemented, then sort of these services should be created around Bitcoin. At the end of the day, will some of these more DLT enterprise type of systems take off? I'm a little skeptical, but all of this is, we're in such infancy, there's so much talent, there's so much money involved, like, just gonna see a lot of experimentation. Crypto's not going away, and, you know, hopefully just quality stuff filters out at the end of the day.
Would you say that we're still in 1998 at the time of the internet age?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I won't peg an exact year, but that sounds pretty accurate, yeah.
And as a last question, what is your favorite altcoin?
I would say I've definitely liked the privacy currencies the most. So I would say right now I'm looking at Grin. It's pretty interesting, a new privacy coin. In the past, both Zcash and Monero I like in slightly discase, like for various reasons, but I like the privacy currency use case, makes a lot of sense.
All right, thank you so much. Thanks for
having me. Thank you, man. Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Tune in for more interviews and videos.